Hello everyone, I am Dr. S.K. Muthal. Welcome today to the new lecture on the subject of corporate accounting. In this lecture, we are going to start a new topic, valuation of shares. Friends, there are different motives for which the shares are purchased. Speculation motive, investment motive, and control motive. Some persons are interested in purchasing shares for speculative purpose. They want to dispose of shares when the price rise in the market. They are influenced by price fluctuations. Some person wants to purchase shares purely from investment motive. They are influenced by security covered offered by the assets of the company, while some others are interested in purchasing the shares of acquiring the control of some other company. They are influenced by security, general prospect, and other factors. In most cases, shares are quoted on the stock exchange, and generally, the price prevailing on the stock exchange may be taken as the proper value. But all the shares are not quoted on the stock exchange. Shares of private companies are not quoted. Valuation of shares is required for transfer of shares in private companies and of other unquoted shares. It is not only the shares of private companies and unquoted shares of public companies that need valuation. Sometimes, as the case of proposed merger or for acquisition of large blocks of shares, it becomes necessary to value even the quoted shares of public companies. The stock exchange price of the shares may not represent the correct financial position of the company because stock exchange prices are affected by external factors such as demand and supply, the bank rate, taxation, and political conditions, which are beyond the control of the company. Though the company fixed the value of its shares, which is termed as face value, the actual price may be different, and therefore it becomes necessary to value the shares in the following circumstances. When unquoted shares are to be sold by the shareholders for estate duty purpose at the time of amalgamation, absorption, and external reconstruction. If loans is to be raised on the security of shares, conversion of one class of shares into another class, etc. The valuation of shares for estate duty purpose is to be made as per the Estate Duty Act. In other cases, there are no statutory provisions prescribing the mode of shares valuation. Some regulatory provisions may be incorporated in articles of association. There are two conventional methods of valuation of shares. First is net asset method, and second one is yield method. The trend of judicial decisions seems to be that the assessment of the value of shares must be based on primarily on the income yield, but regard must also be had to the asset backing. The investors in an open market are more directly influenced by the earning power of the shares than by their asset backing. But the asset should be considered for security and continuity of returns. Now the first method of valuation of shares is net asset method. This method is also called balance sheet method or asset backing method or intrinsic value method or breakup value method. Under this method, an attempt is made to determine as to how much amount per share a shareholder will receive on the date of determination of the value of shares. For this purpose, it is necessary to determine the net asset of the business as on that date. Net asset means the total of realizable assets, including non-trading investment and goodwill, less the total of third-party liabilities. Therefore, in this method, the first step is first to take present or market value of each tangible asset, including goodwill. Non-trading investment will also be taken. If current realizable values are not given, then the balance sheet figures will be taken as the realizable value. Fictitious items like preliminary expenses or discount on issue of shares or debentures will be eliminated. After that, from the total asset, third party or external liabilities, including any contingent liability, will be deducted, and this will give us the net asset. Therefore, net asset is equal to realizable asset minus outside liability. Friends, the next step is, if there are preference shares, then from the net assets which we have calculated in step number 2, then from net asset, preference share capital will be deducted, being the preferential as to return of capital, and the remaining balance will for the assets backing for equity shares. After third step, the next one is the balance of net asset available for equity shares is to be divided by the number of equity shares subscribed, and the result will be the intrinsic value of the shares. Therefore, the intrinsic value of shares is equal to net asset available for equity shareholder divided by total number of equity shares. Friends, where there are equity shares of different paid-up values, the total assets backing for equity shares or equity fund being divided by the total amount of paid-up equity capital, but not the number of shares, gives the value per rupee of paid-up equity capital. This will be multiplied by actual paid-up value of each class of shares, and we get the intrinsic value of each class of shares. This method is generally not recommended for going concern, as yield or earning is the main factor in their case. However, it is suitable for investment companies and the companies having highly uneven past results. Friends, this method of valuation may be the only choice, since no reliable information is available about the expected earning of the company. This method is also suitable for a company which has been showing consistent losses with no apparent prospect of recovery. थैंक यू फ्रेंड्स।